morning. Today is Wednesday, September the 8th, and it's good to be with you this morning. Hope you had a good night's rest and are ready to start the day. Perhaps have already had some quiet time with the Lord on your own, and now you're joining on the devotion this morning. I want to make you aware of a couple of things. I got news from Vonda Knox this morning. She's Vanessa Neely's sister. She stayed with her last night after Vanessa had her first round of chemotherapy. And Vonda let me know that thus far, no side effects. And so that's good. She's trying to rest some this morning. So continue to pray for Vanessa as she starts this journey. And then Sunday, this coming Sunday, between the hours of 2 p.m. and 4 p.m., we've organized a drive-by prayer time with the Petresca family, and their address, you can get that either at church or call the church office to get their address. We don't want to post that on any social media platforms, but encourage you, if you can, to come by and pray for the family. Just a brief come by, drop, maybe get out of the car, and Stan Leo will be at the window, and just pray for him. He begins his transfusion on next Monday as I go to Augusta for that. So if you can make that, if you can't make it personally, from 2 to 4, stop during the day hours and pray for them as he begins that. Well, this morning I wanted to start with the old hymn. I haven't done it in a long time, I think, but it just was fresh on my mind this morning as I got up. It's How Marvelous. Or some may know it as I Stand Amazed. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Just meditate on that as we sing this first verse. I stand amazed, I stand. A sinner condemned and naked, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for. My sins and my sorrows, made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. Let's sing it out, how marvelous. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. With the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see. Love for me. How marvelous, wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Now that's a thought to meditate on for the rest of the day. Amen. I love the first line of that first verse. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner, condemned, unclean. You know, I think that's the first step in becoming born again, is recognize, not, I don't think, this comes from Scripture, that until we recognize that we're completely undone, that in of ourselves, we cannot possibly save ourselves. We can't do enough righteous things to make us clean, holy, to stand in the presence of God and be in a relationship with Him. And turning to that, recognizing that, is the first step in that beginning process of sanctification, of being saved. And from that point, we're willing to turn from living life according to our way and our own means, turn from sin, and turn to Jesus. How amazing is His love? I saw a name popped up that I hadn't seen in a long time. Audrey, it's good to see you. Hope things are going well up in North Georgia in your retirement years. This morning we're going to pick up in John chapter 4, beginning in the 46th verse, after Jesus had been there in Samaria with the woman at the well, and many of the town came out to hear him. And now they believed in him, not by the woman's testimony, but by his own words. Now that they'd seen him, they placed their trust in him. And there's a key phrase at the end of verse 42 before we, at the end of verse 42, where it says that, that we know that indeed you are the Savior of the world. Very key, because the Samaritans are saying this. You see, the Jews thought that he was only the Savior of the Jews, but he's the Savior of the world. God has always been willing and wanting to save the world, for God so loved the world, all ethnicities, all makeup. And when we come to Christ, we are one in Christ. We are part of the family, the children of God, a very blended and mixed family. But praise God for that. From every tongue, tribe, and nation, the book of Revelation tells us, we'll be there before the throne, worshiping Him. And so God does not discriminate in that way. Any person that's willing to admit that they're a sinner, repent from their sin, and trust Christ for their salvation becomes a part of the family of God. And that's a beautiful thing. So in verse 46 now, he leaves Samaria and he comes back down to Galilee. Remember, Galilee was the place where he performed his first miracle, where he turned the water into wine. Now, John tells us this is a second sign that Jesus did as he comes to Galilee. So he came to Cana in Galilee, where he had made water wine. And at Capernaum, there was an official whose son was ill, a royal official. Some translations say perhaps it was an official who served under King Herod. We're not sure, but he was a man of prominence and importance, and he was there, and his son was ill. When this man heard that Jesus had come from Judea to Galilee, he went to him and asked him to come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. The son was at the point of death. So this father hears that Jesus is there, and evidently, obviously, he had heard of the miracle where Jesus turned the water into wine. And so he goes to Jesus out of a need to see his son healed, who is at the point of death. And so Jesus said to him, unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. Now, in the original language in the Greek, unless y'all see. Jesus is not just speaking to the royal official here. He's speaking to all of those in Galilee, all those in Capernaum. And the indictment there is that unless you see a sign and a wonder, you will not believe. In other words, inferring that the only thing that they were looking for was a sign and a wonder. They really didn't have a concern of righteousness. They didn't have a concern of following God, of trusting in Christ, but they just wanted to see signs and wonders, the miraculous. And you know, we're not any different today. There are many that go around always seeking after a sign or a wonder. And Jesus said, unless you see a sign or a wonder, you will not believe. It's an interesting contrast, I think, that John brings to us in Scripture here. Unlike the Samaritans that heard the testimony of that woman, and there was no sign that was done there, there was no miraculous event that took place, Jesus had simply just spoken to the woman's heart and had identified the root cause of her longing, and that was that she was trying to find love in all the wrong places, so to speak. And it was based on her testimony as she went back into the city to tell all the people there, come see a man who told me everything about myself. So they came out based on that testimony, and they heard the words of Jesus. They heard the teaching of Jesus. They heard who he was and recognized him as Messiah, the Savior of the world, and they placed their faith in him. And can I say that where one's faith is placed in God through Christ, where there is a conviction based on the Word of God, is far more sustainable than one who might just be following after a sign and a wonder. You see, there are many people that go for signs, and we see in Scripture a number of times those who came after Jesus, those who followed after Jesus, simply because they had seen a sign and a wonder. But when his teaching got hard, when it hit home, so to speak, all of a sudden we see them vanishing from Jesus. There's an example of this in Matthew chapter 12, verses 28 and 29, or 38 and 39, where the Pharisees had come to Jesus and they asked him, "Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you." But Jesus answered and said, "An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah." And so here Jesus says, a wicked, a perverse, an evil generation just seeks after a sign or a wonder, a miracle. But no sign will be given except for the sign of Jonah. What Jesus was making reference to, as Jonah was in the belly of the well for 3 days, and then he was cast out, vomited out of the well onto the shores of Nineveh to preach, proclaim God there. Jesus was making a reference to what would take place with him, that he would die, he would be crucified, he would be buried, and he would be raised again on the third day. That's the greatest miracle that has ever taken place. And there is substantial evidence for the miracle of Jesus' resurrection. There's no denying it. Yet, we still find people today looking for another sign. So Jesus says, this is the only sign that I'm going to give to you. If you flip over another page in John chapter 6, verse 2, John records for us, "And a large crowd was following him," that is Jesus, "because they saw the signs that he was doing on the sick." Now, I'm not degrading or minimizing the signs that Jesus did. But the signs and the wonders were always, always, always done in order to display the power of God, Jesus as being God the Son, all fullness and deity, to bring others to trust him and know him. One last verse I want to read to you. Luke chapter 23, verse 8. Luke chapter 23, verse 8. And these are just a few verses that we find in the Gospels related to signs and wonders. Luke chapter 23, verse 8, if I can get there. Here we are. "Even Herod himself was amazed by the signs of Jesus." And in verse 8, of chapter 23, it says, "When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had long desired to see him because he had heard about him and he was baptizing, he was hoping to see some sign done by him." Signs and wonders can still take place today, and they do. We shouldn't be surprised when God performs a miracle. He doesn't always perform a miracle, but he does. So we can't discount that that can and does happen today. But the point of this is that we should not seek after signs and wonders. Listen, the evidence, the absolute concrete evidence in your life and in my life that Jesus is in fact Messiah is that he has saved us and transformed our lives. That is the greatest evidence that there is. If you had known J-Mo before he came to know Christ, you would say, that's a miracle. Knowing some of you and hearing some of your testimonies, that is a miracle that God had saved you. That is the only sign, that is the only wonder we need. The Bible, again, in Romans, says that faith comes by hearing and that of the Word of God. You see, saving faith is placing our trust in the gospel message that God sent his Son to die on a cross, to shed his blood for the payment and forgiveness of our sin. He was buried and he was raised again on the third day. If anyone would confess with his mouth that Jesus is Lord and that he rose from the dead, he will be saved. And so that's the only sign that we need. We'll finish the story. And so Jesus answers this official in verse 50. He says, go, your son will live. Now, it's kind of ironic that Jesus would answer him this way after he's just rebuked the rest of those in Capernaum. So I don't think he was making that statement to the official that he will only believe if he sees a sign, because he turns now and he tells him, your son will live. The man believed the what? Word that Jesus spoke. Here we are again. He didn't have to see the sign that his son had been healed. He believed the word that Jesus spoke to him, and he went on his way. He took it as what Jesus said. Hey, your son is going to be healed. You see, we have to take God at his word and not doubt him at his word. You see, that's an unbelieving heart, tossed to and fro, as James tells us in his letter. So verse 51, as he was going down, his servants met him and told him that his son was recovering. So he asked them the hour when he began to get better. And they said, yesterday at the seventh hour, which is about 1 p.m., the fever left him. The father knew that this was the hour when Jesus had said to him, your son will live. And he himself believed, trusted, and all of his household as well. This was now the second sign that Jesus did when he had come from Judea to Galilee. This morning, in closing, let me encourage you to trust God at his word. Trust and believe what God says. It is tried and proven. Don't seek after any wonder. Don't seek after any sign, because what happens when those aren't there? Then we begin to manufacture them or try to find somewhere that manufactures signs. Listen, God's word and God's word alone is sufficient not only for salvation, but is sufficient to transform, change our lives. And that's all that we need, is the word of God. And we place our trust in what God says. Now, this morning in closing, I want to encourage you to pray and ask God, God, give me an opportunity today to plant a seed of the gospel in somebody's heart, to share my story of how Jesus saved me with somebody else. And then if we recognize that maybe that has already taken place in their life and they've had a seed sown, that God give us the wisdom to know how to cultivate that seed, to water that seed. And if God, by his grace, would allow us to see him save somebody, that we'd participate in the harvest, that we would see somebody come to Christ. Make that your prayer today. It should be our prayer every day. God, use us where we are. That's what we should be about, is the gospel. I love you. I pray the Lord's blessings on you, that he keep you. I look forward to seeing you those tonight, our women's study, small group studies at 6 p.m., and our men's small group studies at 6 p.m., student ministry, children, preschool. I love you. I pray the Lord's blessings on you. Have a great day.